In this video, I recap issue 2 from Boom Studios' Expanse miniseries, bridging the gap between seasons 4 and 5. Bobbie and Avasarala continue their struggle to uncover the truth of a secret cabal claiming they can unite Earth, Mars, and the Belt. If you need to catch up, click the card in the upper right corner for issue 1. On to the recap. Bobbie Draper's pursuers follow her footsteps and find they suddenly stop. Where did she go? They surmise she must have had an accomplice with transportation. They run off as the one in charge says, "Come on, if we hurry, we can put a stop and search on every returning craft in this sector." Bobbie watches from a distance as she clutches a bullet wound on her right arm. "Guess training isn't what it used to be," she thinks, "because there is no way I did that good a job erasing my footsteps. Not one-handed." Then, stranded on the empty landscape of Mars, she calls Cal for help. "All right, Mr. Good Business," she thinks, "it's time to put some things to the test." Meanwhile, on Luna, Ashanti asks her mother, Christian Avasarala, to see her off. Christian is too busy to do so, but at least tries to get her a better seat. She looks over the passenger list to see who owes her a favor, and is surprised to find one of her subordinates, Lance Slavitt, on the list. On second thought, Avasarala says, "I will come with you." At the terminal, Christian says goodbye to her daughter and adds, "Pretend to listen to your father. That's the best way to care for him, all right?" Ashanti disagrees. "You coming to visit would be the best thing for him." "I'm not so sure about that, darling," Christian replies. They part ways and Christian spots Lance. She questions him on why he's so suddenly heading to Earth without a return ticket. Cornered, Lance admits that he is resigning. He's found a better job where he gets to work on something he can believe in. "No offense," Lance adds, "that's just not something you can offer me." On Mars, Bobbie hitches a ride in Cal's transport. "I can't imagine what you were doing out there at this hour," Cal says. After confirming that Cal can keep a secret, she admits, "Well, what I was doing wasn't exactly sanctioned. I was trying for some salvage, off the books." Cal chides her for her recklessness, and she defends herself. "Do you see much more work around here? Sometimes you take what you can get." Cal responds, "Bobbie, what if there was something better? I know you once told me you'd never leave Mars. Has that changed?" "Hmm," Bobbie answers. "Let me ponder that while I slip into your cargo hold and try to find your first aid kit." At the sector entrance, Cal is stopped by some guards. They insist on searching his vehicle, but with Bobbie in the cargo hold, he claims to be traveling alone. The guard is unimpressed, but once Cal shows his identification, the guard apologizes and allows him to proceed. Once safely inside, Bobbie asks if Cal will finally elaborate on whatever scheme he's involved in. "And risk there being no reason for you to call me again?" Cal says. "I think I'll save it for another night." Then he offers Bobbie a nightcap, and she politely turns him down, but offers that, "Tomorrow is a new day." "It's a date," Cal says. Then they part ways. In her apartment, Bobbie tends to her wound and records a message for Avasarala, saying she's not any closer to discovering who is behind the weapon sales, but, she adds, "I did get a promising lead on, well, I'm not really sure what it is yet." Back on Luna, Christian listens to Bobbie's message, then hears a noise and checks the hallway. When she sees no one, Christian reassures herself. "Get a hold of yourself. Whatever trouble Bobbie has gotten into is a long way from here. Unless..." She calls an old Belter friend of hers, Justin Whiteley, and does some of her own investigating. She asks if he's noticed people being hired away by a mysterious conglomerate. At first, he dodges her questions, but finally, Avasarala insists, "A blunt answer, please. Is there someone with a lot of money hiring away your people?" "Well, yes," Justin replies, "both from this project and across the belt. But we don't know who is behind it. It's as annoying as hell. You get someone trained and..." Suddenly, an intruder appears behind Christian, interrupting the call and grabbing her phone. She is, of course, unintimidated. "It's customary to knock before entering," she says. "Or did no one ever teach you courtesy? You think you know something about us, but we're fairly sure you don't," the intruder says. "Is that a threat?" Christian asks. "Not at all," she responds. She asks for her phone back, and the intruder hands it to her with a smile. "I'm here to offer you an opportunity. As a gesture of friendship." "You have my attention," she replies. However, the intruder grabs her again when she notices Avasarala attempting to quietly call security. then lets her know it wouldn't work anyway. They've blocked all local communications for the next 6 hours. The intruder pushes her against a table and continues the pitch. You knew a lot about how to run things on Earth not long ago, but did anyone really listen? No. But what would you say if I told you that I know a place where people would listen? Wouldn't that be a place where you could create a paradise? Meanwhile, Bobby's evening has grown much quieter. In her room, she wonders if Cal is the reason she hasn't been taken in yet. She definitely left some blood behind after the gunfight. Maybe he sells get-out-of-jail-free cards, she wonders. Or maybe get-off-the-planet-free cards. Maybe. Just maybe that wouldn't be so bad right about now. Then she heads to bed, determined to get a rare night of real sleep, and makes sure to put her phone away, somewhere far from bed. I'm sleeping in tomorrow, she thinks, no matter what. Avasarala continues her less than friendly discussion. Where exactly are you building this Shangri-La? Certainly not Earth. Not even close, the intruder says. We're building something new, from the ground up. Obviously you've noticed, and if you noticed, others have too. She wonders aloud why they would contact her now, given she's in no position to help them. The stranger insists that's not true. Avasarala has eyes and ears everywhere. They would make it worth her while to get those eyes and ears to look the other way. Avasarala quietly lets her bracelet slip to the floor while the stranger speaks. Then she grabs it and throws it in the intruder's face, giving her a chance to run. At the door, she spots a man she doesn't know walking through the halls and quickly joins him. What's your name again? She asks. I'm Jebin, the man replies. Jebin Kartner. Jebin, Avasarala says. I don't believe we've been formally introduced prior to this moment. Walk with me, won't you? Her intruder watches the two leave, unable to act with this new witness present. They are followed, however, as she accompanies Jebin on his train. Once they reach his station, one of Avasarala's pursuers holds the train for her. I'll hold the door for you, ma'am. I do believe you've traveled too far. Jebin leaves and Avasarala runs. She finds a place requiring authorized access where the man chasing her can't get in. Though she'll have other dangers to contend with. In 68 minutes, the atmosphere will cycle and supplementary oxygen will be required, something she does not have access to as the only suit she could find did not have a helmet. She makes her way through the temporarily livable quarters and has a thought. According to her intruder, local communications would be blocked for another 5 hours. But what about an off-world call? She sends a message and thinks, now for the hard part, waiting. 1 second later, a phone rings on Earth, and it is ignored while Avasarala's daughter plays at the park. 1 minute later, another phone rings on Earth, and the call is declined. Christian's husband, Arjun, just isn't ready to talk to her yet, unless she wants to do it in person. On Mars, 22 minutes later, Bobby's phone rings uselessly in a drawer, far from her bed while she sleeps soundly. 30 minutes later, on the Rocinante, James Holden notices that he has no phone signal. Damn it, Avasarala says. I hate waiting. Then she sits and quietly hopes for someone to call back. And that's where issue 2 wraps up. Let me know what you thought of the issue in the comments, where you think it's heading, and how it will lead into what we've seen of season 5. And if you enjoyed this video, please go ahead and hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, and hit the bell icon. That way you'll get notified as we post more Expanse content, including a similar video for issue 3. With that, thanks for watching and see you on the next One Take.